Hey guys, we're doing a small upgrade for our cooling system for the 350Z. To go through this job, I'm using my Haynes manual to help guide me through it. Today I am going to work on the cooling system for the 350Z. You can see I've already started a little bit to make life easier. I have removed the factory air box to be able to get at all these cooling lines and also make it easier for you guys to see. You can see over here the factory air box lays right here. It's very hard to get at this particular cooling line without trying to like really shove your hands in here. You're gonna make your life really hard. So take the time to disassemble the vehicle a little bit and make yourself some more room. So I picked up a couple parts here, so you can see I have new lines for the radiator. These ones are from Z1 Motorsports, and these are made out of silicone. So these ones, in theory, I will never have to change again. Rubber ones do last a pretty long time, but I never want to deal with changing these out anymore, and I like the look of them. There is one thing that you will have to make sure you do, though, is you have to check your coolant levels a little bit more often. From what I've been researching, these have the ability to sweat compared to rubber. So rubber for a daily driver still might be the better way to go. But for those of you that are a lot more attentive to your vehicles and want to have something that looks nicer and can perform a little bit better as far as heat transfer goes, you might want to look at these silicone lines. If you want to have something that's a little bit more trouble free without having to check the coolant more often, you might want to go with the factory rubber hoses. Over here you can see I have two thermostats. Actually, I just wanted to show you guys this one, because I think next month we might be doing another giveaway. So this is a Mishimoto thermostat, and then here I have a factory style Aisin one. And they look identical except one opens earlier. That would be the Mishimoto. Now the way I use my vehicle, I am going to put in this Aisin one. The reason why I picked this one, I was looking at Rock Auto, I was looking at the pictures, because there's a big advantage. If you have a friend that's at the parts store, check out the parts, because this one's made in Japan. It does cost more. This was like 40 something odd dollars. A Motorrad one was like 13. But even just looking at the pictures, you can tell the Japanese one, they just try harder. Like the way it's machined here, where the hose hooks up to, it's machined, while in the Motorrad one it looks like it's just cast. It just looks like a better quality overall part. It is a factory style replacement, so I'm going to trust this one more. It's a few extra bucks, but when it comes to coolant, I don't think you can really chintz on something like this, because it doesn't, 40 something odd dollars isn't the end of the world, and I want to make sure that it operates properly. I'm not saying that the Motorrad ones or the cheaper ones won't work, but for me, peace of mind, I would rather get the one that's made in Japan. Looking at the two thermostats, they look identical. You can see the Mishimoto one, same thing, nicely machined over here. The flanges are same thickness, they feel like the same weight. Everything's in the same position, jingle pin, everything. Like, you really couldn't, it's really hard to tell the two apart if it wasn't for this made in Japan little engraving over here for the Aisin one. So the only thing that you can tell difference is one has a harder spring than the other. So the Mishimoto one opens up sooner, and this one's more factory style. So I was reading, this one says 170 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm assuming that's partial, because there's another section of Rock Auto where they had it at 180 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm not sure if what the actual factory spec is, but this is listed for factory spec. If it's 10 degrees Fahrenheit lower, not a big deal. It's probably going to work perfectly for what I'm doing, because this car only drives in the summertime. I usually encounter 25 degrees Celsius to 35 degrees Celsius in my area. So this is going to work perfectly. And the reason why I'm going with the Aisin one is because if you are not driving your vehicle on the track, or you don't have standalone engine management, you can't reprogram the computer for all its parameters. If I put in the Mishimoto one, if my vehicle does not hit operating temperature within roughly, let's say, about 10 minutes, you're likely to get a check engine light. I've been reading there are a lot of people that put this in and tend to have a check engine light. Nothing is wrong with the vehicle, it's just that the vehicle's parameters, it's seeing something that it shouldn't. So that's why I'm going to go with this guy over here, because of the way I'm driving the vehicle, I really do want to get to operating temperature sooner. The reason why I want to get to operating temperature sooner is because that's where a lot of wear and tear actually happens. when you start a vehicle, you know, you want to let it warm up for a few seconds, you know, 30 seconds, just let it idle, let the oil pump its way, let the oil try to get to operating temperature. And if I have a vehicle running cool in street driving situations right off the bat, and I have to drive, I would have to drive it slower until everything gets up to operating temperature. So going with this makes more sense to me for my application. So to recap, there is nothing wrong with the Mishimoto one. It is just as good. Like comparing them side by side, this, like you can't tell, like they're both machined beautifully, both high quality pieces. But I'm just saying, for my particular application, this probably, because it's opening sooner, it's just probably not right for me. If I was driving on the track though, or if this was going to see really hot temperatures, this is probably the better one to go with. But if you're just going to do mountain driving, if you're going to drive in the city, go through different variances in temperature, and also drive on the highway long distances, this one's probably going to be the best one for you guys. As for coolant, we're going to be using Nissan factory fill. We're not doing a full flush today, but we are going to be draining the radiator, and we're going to have to refill it and bleed the system in order for this thing to work properly. So I'm using their concentrate. This is what we used last time, and we are using it with distilled water. I'm going to change my mixture a bit. We did 50-50 last time, and because mainly I'm running at hotter temperatures, I'm going to be probably going to do like a 60-40 split, possibly 70-30. The interesting thing is water has the ability to exchange heat very well, but it has a very low boiling point. So when you add coolant, the coolant will actually raise the boiling point, but if you went straight coolant, let's say you did 100% of this stuff, it doesn't exchange heat that well. That's why they introduced a 50-50 mix. That way you can run it in the summer and also the winter and not have to worry about it. So, and you also have to run coolant because water isn't great to react with metal. So this helps prevent corrosion and helps the water pump last longer. So there are a lot of other properties that you need this for as well. So unless it's a race car, yeah, you can run straight water. This is a street car. We have to do some sort of mixture. Also keep in mind, guys, when it comes to coolant, there's so many ways that, or so many different materials that manufacturers are using. Back in the day, used to be like, okay, if it's green, I just put green stuff in. Or if it's red, like if you have a GM that uses Dexcool, I only use the red stuff. Never mix, obviously, but it's become a little more complicated. So you guys have to really look at your owner's manual, and it will specifically tell you the type of coolant that you can put in that is acceptable, that way it doesn't react or do anything bad to the metal. So Nissan, from what I've read, has updated their coolant, but this stuff is much better suited for aluminum material. Well, if you look at like old school green stuff, even though this is green too, if you look at old school green stuff and you read about it, it's designed more for steel or iron parts, like an older engine. So just if you're not sure, spend a couple extra bucks and go to the dealership and get the factory fill stuff. When you guys purchase your new thermostat, doesn't matter if you buy the cheaper one, the more expensive one, it's probably not going to come in the gasket. So I decided to get the one from Nissan while I was getting the coolant. It's a whopping $7. The generic one at the local auto parts store was about $3-something. Yeah, just under $4. The reason why I picked this one, it doesn't cost them more extra money. I've had no issues whatsoever with leaks in my cooling system. So I'm just going to put in this guy because I know it works. The thermostat is bare metal, so what I do is I just cut a X into the box, so it's just a nice little stand. I mask it off, and I just quickly shoot it with clear, just a thin coat, because I just want it to look the same over time. I hope I don't have to tell you guys this, but before you start the job, make sure the engine is completely cold when you're dealing with coolant, or anything on the engine in general. When you're doing this job, you guys are going to be working near the cooling fans. And just to be safe, let's disconnect the negative terminal just in case we don't want those turning on by accident. To begin the job, we are going to need to catch the fluid. So the nice thing about this particular radiator is it does have a drain plug. So we just have to take a Phillips in here. It is plastic, so be careful. And we have to unscrew it to drain it all out. And then we have to catch into a bucket because we can't just throw this stuff out. We have to bring it back to our local mechanic or some sort of disposal facility. That way we can take care of the old fluid and not just be harmful to the environment and throw it in the drain. We are now about to drain the radiator, so I have the cap off, but I have it loose. I don't have it completely off. I don't want any debris getting in there just in case. And we get underneath. I have a large Phillips number 3 head. That's just because it just fits better. If you use the number 2, you might strip this. And you want to take this out. Don't do what I do. That's just wearing gloves. Now we wait.
If you're waiting,
I don't know. Have a snack with you or something. I like these because they remind me when I was a kid.
Everything's all drained out.
Let's go ahead and tighten that up. I'd use a screwdriver. I wouldn't put something on a ratchet or anything because you're going to develop a lot of torque and you have a very high chance of breaking this guy.
To get warmed up, let's work on the top hose. You can see we have these self-tensioning clamps. I like to use my channel locks, squeeze it together and move it over, then repeat the process for the other one. This one's easier to take off, but this one has been formed over the metal with the clamp over time. It's just so hard. So since I'm changing out these hoses, I am cheating and I'm cutting them off. If you are obviously going to reuse these, you can't do that. You will have to wrestle it off. But if you're putting in new hoses, save yourself some time. For the mill hose, just take a flathead screwdriver and you can release the clamps. Be careful with these. They are plastic. They are get pretty dry with all the heat. So you have to make sure that you attack at the right point. That way you'll release and you won't break them. These hoses are old and they're on there pretty good. So for the hose that comes across the engine, don't even try to take this clamp off this way because it's flared over here at the end. I'm finding it's a lot easier to push it over this way and then cut a small relief cut in here and then just start to pull on it. So I'm not sure if you guys can tell. So I had it at the end, I kept pulling on it, bring it forward, and now I have my clamp loose. And it's gonna be a lot easier to pull this out because typically what most people, like I tried it too, trying to get that clamp to open up its diameter big enough to go over here, it was just, you just can't. So I find if I just leave it over here, I can just go ahead and pull this. Same thing over here, so I'm wrestling it, cutting a slit, pushing it down while pulling it up to get it out. So much easier when you cut it. Now, the only one I can't cut is this one. I am not replacing that one. It's in good condition. I do like the fact that it seems that Nissan pre-bends them. That way it loops around here. There are other hoses you can get where they replace this with silicone hose, but it's kind of straight, so you have to kind of loop it around bigger. And remember, you have to deal with the belts and everything. And so they did shape it to fit in here. So if you do need to replace this, I would prefer to use the factory one. But if it's in good condition, you don't have to. But we cannot cut this one either. So if you guys can see that, that actually helps. Because I can't see it from up here. So I'm actually looking at the camera. So you'll have to do a little blind and get your pliers on there to take this hose clamp off.
You guys are probably going to find this hard to pull off because it's just been on there for so long. So if you are trying to get this hose off and you're trying to save it, don't just pull on it. It's not going to really budge. You kind of have to break it free. So just get a set of pliers at the end of it and twist it as you're going along and pulling. That'll help break everything free and you'll be able to slide this off.
Just have to remove the thermostat now. So there are 3 10 mils you'll have to remove and this will just pop right off.
It's our original one. Oh, where's the gasket? Here is our new gasket, and this is our old one. So feeling the old one, it feels completely flat, but you can see on the new one, there is a ridge. And this is why I want to go with the factory one, because that's going to give us a nice seal, because that will crush and make sure that if there's any imperfections on the surface, it's going to seal it nicely. Check the orientation of the gasket when you're putting on your new thermostat. Now, it will only go on one way, but just double check to make sure all the holes line up, and the opening over here is the exact same. When I reinstall my thermostat, I'm going to use two bolts in through the gasket. This way I know everything's lined up when I'm placing it in. My service manual says to tighten it down to 80 inch-pounds, so you want to get out your torque wrench and secure it tightly. The reason why you want to get a torque wrench on this as opposed to just doing it snug on a piece like this, you want to make sure you have pretty exact even pressure along the housing, that way you create a good seal. If you're not familiar with the torque wrench, especially when you're working on small aluminum parts like on this aluminum engine, go up in increments. So start off at like 50 inch-pounds, then work your way up. That way you know it's actually working. If you have no idea if your tool is working properly, go get it calibrated. Before putting in your new hoses, you want to make sure that they are the same. So you can see here, the factory one is a little bit shorter than our aftermarket, so we will have to trim it a bit, or else it's going to want to kink itself when we put it back on. I've marked my cut with tape using as a guide. I'm using a razor blade to make a nice clean cut all the way around. Okay, so we're now the same length, pretty clean cut that we have over here. Also with these parts, whether you have to cut it or not, I would recommend just rinsing it through water really quickly to make sure. There could be some debris in there and packaging, you never know, these are held in a warehouse. So just clean it with water quickly, making sure it's nice and dry, clear of any contaminants before you put this back onto the engine. I think one of the most important things when you are putting on any kind of hose is to make sure that the bottom, because you can't see it while you're putting it on, isn't folding up and going in. I did that once on my intake tube, and then I had a vacuum leak. It's a little bit hard to do on these, but just be mindful, like if it's not going on, maybe try twisting it on. But these new hoses are pretty forgiving, and make sure that you put the clamps on first before you fit them back onto the engine. When you're installing them, you can fold them up quite a bit in order to squeeze it back or push it back, and then you can get it onto your radiator. Again, I am always comparing the orientation because they look really similar on both ends, but there is a top and a bottom. So I note which is the end I took out, and I'm comparing it so I know which orientation I have to put my new hose in. The lower radiator hose is pretty straightforward, so I'm going to come up and down through the engine bay. That way I can go back onto the thermostat housing, and then I can attach the lower portion of the radiator. And then all we have to do is put our clamps back on. We now have all our new hoses in, our new thermostat, and we are ready to put in our factory airbox and then fill up our radiator. So quick notes here, we did have to trim this a bit on length. I would rather have too much than too little. Some people might be like, oh, well, they should have got it perfect. You never know. It's just better. It wasn't that hard to cut it. Just use a razor blade. You might also notice that I have worm clamps on this guy over here and down here. These clamps, don't even bother trying to squeeze these and getting it over. Save yourself the hassle. You saw how much hassle I had just getting this off. So with a worm clamp over here, I don't have to deal with it if I ever have to take it off. Now, you do have to be a little bit more mindful. There's a reason why factories use these self-tensioning ones, because they will never let go over time, while this one, in theory, potentially can. So you might want to double-check it over time. Also, do not over-crank on these worm clamps, because this material is so soft, it will keep tightening, and then you'll start cutting into the material into these little grooves for the bolt. That's what the bolt uses to tighten itself. So if you keep tightening it, these will act like a cheese grater, basically. So just don't he-man it on. For the most part, it wasn't too bad to do this job. Like, yes, this guy sucked. You sucked. You definitely sucked. The trick here was using the pliers to break it free. So you have to be really patient. If you're not changing out hoses, if you're doing a radiator job, for whatever reason, and you're just disconnecting lines and you are not replacing them, you might have a bit more of a hassle. I did cheat by cutting them. But if your vehicle is older and these are the original hose lines, it's not a bad idea to either go pick up the factory ones or pick up ones like these. We're about to fill the cooling system with fluid again. So you can see here we have a special funnel with an adapter. This allows us to
basically make the job easier because it's a lot easier to fill it. I can fill this up to a third of the way full, and this will take in the fluid as I run the engine, and this will help eliminate any air bubbles. Now, you still might get air and you're gonna have to bleed the system, but this is gonna make life a lot easier because now this is the highest point. We're gonna leave the vehicle the way it is with the engine up higher than the rear, and we're also gonna come over here to the bleeder screw and see it over here. Take our big screwdriver, and we're gonna open it up. As we fill this, according to the service manual, we want fluid to come out of here first. That's even before we even run the engine. We're gonna fill this up as slowly as we can. About to pull out. There we go. Up, up. So now we can go ahead and close our bleeder screw. So traditionally, if you squeeze it, you can get some air bubbles. We're just pushing air out, but we had some bubbles come out. But we're going to leave it at a third, and we're going to run the engine and let the engine take in the coolant and keep topping it off. We're about to run the engine. Make sure you're in neutral. Set the heat up high and turn on your fan. I can see the bucket from here, so I keep an eye on it. So we're reading our instructions. And basically it says rev the engine to approximately 2500 RPM for 10 seconds, let idle, do this a few times, turn the engine off and let it cool, and add more coolant mixture, bring level back. So we don't have to, the nice thing about that is I don't have to keep checking the level, I can just see it from here. So we're gonna bring it to 2500. We're gonna do that a few times. Right now we're waiting for the vehicle to get up to operating temperature because we need the thermostat to open so that way the coolant starts flowing through the block. See it bubbling though, it's starting to release air.
Yeah.
My cooling fan is just turned on and a bunch of level went down, so it seems that the thermostat is opening. So we are just trying to get more air out of the system right now. No more lying, this is a very time consuming process. As I'm cycling the engine at 2500 RPM and holding it, I have to keep coming and refilling because it's still taking air. I would also let it cool down a couple times. I had to open up the bleeder just a little bit. I didn't release it all the way because it is hot, but when you release the bleeder valve, you can hear a hissing sound. There's air. So now I'm starting to get hot air in the car, which means it's circulating properly. So I filled again. We're gonna do the cycle a few more times. Don't tap the accelerator, like give it quick revs because you want to hear your exhaust. I did that and then air just started blowing in cold, so basically I would see the water come up and come back down. I must have been sucking air back into the system. So just hold it at 2500 RPM when you're doing this. Don't do quick revs until you have your cooling system resealed with your radiator cap back on. You see here where the vehicle cooled down, it has taken everything from our funnel. So we're going to take this off and see how close we are up to the filler neck. Looking pretty good. Before we button everything up, you want to double check our drain plug, check all the lower hoses over here, make sure that we have no leaks, and give it a quick wipe down, and then go ahead and put the belly pan back on. When you're done, inspect the upper hose. These main hoses here off the radiator for upper and lower, they're pretty easy for clearance, but you want to double check that you have it in the correct spot. So we have ever so slightly clearance, but I can see between the hose and the engine. So this is fine for clearance, but if it's like rubbing right up against it, you might have to readjust because it can start to chafe.
And we are done. Double checked everything, reinspected. So when we were testing, we wanted to make sure we keep looking in these areas that we're not getting any leaks, mainly in the thermostat, because the thermostat isn't exactly the easiest thing to look at. We're obviously checking around all every place that we clamped onto, making sure that there is no leaks happening. These are new hoses, so you know you're looking at the entire hose because you never know, like maybe something got damaged in shipping or during the manufacturing process. Is it leaking anywhere? We don't have any leaks. Everything's looking good. We have hot air blowing in finally. That's probably my biggest takeaway from this thing is having this funnel makes a huge difference when you're doing the job by yourself, because you can sit in the car, you can watch the temperature gauge, you can watch over here. It also has a fluid stop, so let's say you overfilled it and the rad's not taking any more fluid. You can put the little stop in, take out the whole funnel. That way you're not pouring coolant all over the place. So it's a really handy tool to have. It's worth spending the money. And you do have to bleed the system several times. Like even though you take off the bleeding screw and then you pour fluid in and then fluid comes out, there's still a ton of air in the system. So you have to be really patient. Like, you know, you're sitting there for like a minute or two and you're like, why is this thing blowing cold air only? Don't worry. If you do the procedure properly and bleed it while you're doing all this, it will come back. So when I was bleeding it, I had the funnel over here. If you put the radiator cap on, if you look at how the system is, it's attached to all this stuff over here. It's under pressure. So I would not suggest opening up the bleeder screw for safety's sake if you have the radiator cap on. Let it cool down a bit. Back it off slowly. You'll hear some air come out. Just be safe when you're dealing with cooling systems in general. You don't want to get hasty and try to get air out of the system when you've capped things off. Let it cool down from time to time. Take your time with it. You know, doing it on your day off, hang out with some buddies, but just take your time when you're doing this process and you'll be fine.
If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way at all times, you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration, informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section and it keeps applying it to different vehicles. Yeah.